Hello and welcome to Great School Movies. Now, what is it about school life which generates such cracking films? Cares, Eve, Dangerous Minds, and High School Musical 3. Just joking about the last one. Well, to find out, we commissioned the biggest ever survey of feature films set in schools. We got together with Film Club, who promote movies within schools, and our online poll sparked a massive response. In a moment, we'll start counting down this fascinating top 10, which tells us an awful lot about the way that teachers see themselves, or rather, want to be seen. Here's just a flavour of what's coming up.
There'll be movies that make you weep.
I burst into tears at that point.
Films that fill you with joy.
We used to sing all the songs in the playground. We did all the dances. It was fantastic.
Our classic number one title song.
Probably the best record that Lulu has ever made.
Confessions of a director.
The little boy who was caned by mistake cried all the way to the piggy bank, I think, because he got an extra 10 bob for that.
And a movie that took risks.
It was really exciting. Because it went where you're not supposed to go.
Now, if you think about it, school life has all the ingredients of great drama. Friendships, self-discovery, humiliation and fun. In fact, for our first film, one voter said, it reminds us all that being a teenager was all about having fun. It remains the highest-grossing musical film of all time, a tale of summer loving between bad boy Danny and very good girl Sandy. Yep, you've guessed it.
Yes, at number 10, Grease is the Word, the original High School Musical released in 1978.
Grease. Goodness. How extraordinary. Summer loving had me
a blast. It was just a perfect pop musical, great.
Particularly Summer Nights. I think it's a really good sort of set up to the film because you've got the girls and the boys. It sets up that opposition that carries on right the way through.
It's just one of those feel-good movies. Very funny, though. Very clever script and just really well done.
Danny goes under the car and comes out the other side into this sort of fantasy space. And that's the convention of the musical itself, moving into sort of a fantasy world.
There is something so romantically playful about this film. It so embodied my own youth. We used to sing all the songs in the playground. We did all the dances. It was fantastic.
Olivia Newton-John's character goes from being this quiet, mousy creature to suddenly sort of developing and flowering and just being completely different to how she started, whereas John Travolta actually, I think, goes the other way. He goes from being sort of the king of the castle, the leader of the group, to sort of coming down when he realises that actually she's the one that he wants.
Olivia Newton-John has been to my house and I wasn't in.
Now, did you know that Olivia Newton-John was pushing 30 when she took the role of the 17-year-old Sandy, and Stockard Channing, who plays Rizzo, was 33? Now, the fresh-faced cast of our next movie were much closer to their on-screen ages.
Even though it was made over 40 years ago, it won praise from teachers who said it was bang up to date in dealing with issues of race, prejudice, and rowdy classroom behaviour. This won't be the last time in this list that we meet the inspirational movie teacher, here played by Sidney Poitier, who eventually wins over a bunch of cynical teenagers.
In at number 9, classroom conflict in London's tough East End, with To Sir With Love.
All you boys, out. The girls, stay where they are.
What's the matter, Mr. Thackeray?
Out! Out!
There's so many fantastic scenes in To Sir With Love, but I think the scene that is quite pivotal in the movie is the moment when he gets the epiphany about exactly what situation that he's in. He's come in very green, he's a new teacher, very tough East End school. Suddenly he's landed with a bunch of 15-year-olds who don't know how to behave. And there's an amazing moment where, after a series of japes, he loses his temper and storms into the staff room.
You're trying to.
Those kids are devils, incarnate, huh? I've tried everything. Everything, but nothing. I tried. Kids.
What?
Kids. That's it.
When he realises that teaching his kids
in a traditional way doesn't work, he then moves on to doing, I suppose, an advanced sort of social skills type of program.
It actually makes you realise how little has changed and how much of what happens in the classroom is very much to do with dealing with social issues like poverty, deprivation, violence in the home, illiteracy, all those kind of issues which we're still dealing with.
What I found really, really interesting was it was very challenging to modern perceptions of the race question.
Last night on the telly, Mr. Thackeray, there was this travelogue picture, you know, a lot of black women dancing around with no tops. Don't they ever dress proper?
What's proper varies throughout the world, depending on customs and climate. For their climate and according to their customs, they were dressed properly.
Are you from South Africa, sir?
Of course not. South Africans is white, isn't they?
A South African is a native of South Africa, regardless of colour.
To have a film that kind of brings all that out is exactly what film is for. To make you think, entertain you, and sort of challenge your perception of the world. So I think it's fantastic film.
He obviously has transformed the young people with his teaching, but at the end, what you begin to see is how they've really, really transformed him.
And as I leave,
the signature song, which is sung by Lulu, is really, really quite special. When she stands up and she sings it at the end, and they all stand and watch him when she's singing it, it's really, really lovely.
A friend who taught me right from wrong and weak from strong, that's a lot to learn.
Very good performance from Sidney Poitier. And probably the best record that Lulu has ever made.
If you wanted the moon, I would...
This movie for me actually has real resonance because I first started teaching in my career in the East End of London, and so I kind of think that there was a sneaky part of me that felt I was sort of going through his journey as well. It's a really inspiring movie and really genuinely moving.
All the emotions that we feel and talk about were portrayed by Poitier very, very poignantly, really. He was just so emotional, you know, the twitching of the lip, the sort of the eyes filling up. And to me, I just thought that was a really, really powerful scene.
I think I'd better go and put it away.
I think it's a classic. I definitely think it's a classic.
There we go. Splendid. Now, our next film is about as sweet as a large bag of sugared popcorn. In my opinion, one of the most charming films ever made in any category. And it's British.
At number 8, the film that had fun overturning sexual stereotypes in the school soccer team. It's Gregory's Girl.
Tick off. Tick off.
One of my concerns about the film was the opening scene. I can actually remember being quite concerned about my parents seeing that.
The story is really all about the hormonal revolution that's going on. You know, what's on the curriculum is love, and I guess particularly unrequited love.
I think the charm of Gregory's Girl is, in many ways, it's like a lot of people's real school experience. So I think that it's extraordinary as well that I'm still talking about it 20 plus years after we made it.
I love the way in which Bill Forsyth, the director, works in a great deal of gender reversals. So there's that great scene where the two boys, Gregory and I think his friend Steve, the cookery expert, are giving out advice about noodle soup and confectionery.
It's 8 ounces of flour, 4 ounces of margarine,
pinch of salt.
Then a couple of scenes later, Dorothy and Susan are doing a science experiment to find pH strength.
What about Alan? Do you think he's still a virgin?
Nah. He's been in the school orchestra for over a year now.
Hey, room 4.
Well, my one great memory of Gregory's Girl is the surreal moment where down the school corridor wanders this hapless penguin.
Everybody, when they watched that film, really cracked up with the penguin scene because in their school, a big secondary school, if anybody was wandering around looking for any place or looking lost, those in the know would say, oh, just go to room 28. And of course, there wasn't a room 28.
Room 16? Hurry.
It's a sign of how utterly surreal school life is and how nothing surprises a teacher.
I wasn't going to hurt him. I fell in a bottle.
My other favourite scene in the film is just after the first practice match, where Gregory has fallen for Dorothy completely. It's just managed and played so beautifully because you get a wonderful innocence matched with a certain kind of erotic edge, because Gregory is doing his best to contain his desire. And yet it is perfectly innocent. So the way in which he was able to do that, to play the innocent and the erotic in the same scene, I think is a mark of a great filmmaker.
Next, a real feel-good Hollywood movie, the tale of one high school teenager's epic day off as he sweet-talks his way around Chicago with his girlfriend and his best mate. I think this contains the best moral excuse ever for bunking off. Life moves pretty fast. If you don't stop and look round once in a while, you'll miss it.
In at 7, and starring Matthew Broderick, is Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
The 1961 Ferrari 250 GT, California.
It's less about Ferris Bueller being the coolest guy in the world. Rather, the adults around him are a load of idiots who just completely don't understand
Adler.
The generation they're teaching.
Here.
Anderson? Anderson?
Here.
Bueller?
One of my favourite scenes from Ferris Bueller's Day Off is, it's kind of two scenes rolled into one. Both of them occur in the classroom. One initially when the teacher is taking the register, calling out the children's names, but in a particularly droning manner to which all the children are bored to tears. And Ferris is obviously absent.
In an effort to alleviate the effects of the...
Anyone? The teacher is teaching, asking very monotone questions. All the pupils are bored to tears. There are children with heads on their desks, heads in their hands.
Polly Smoot.
To me, that's the just epitome of what I think teaching should not be about. Teaching should be creative, it should be fun, and that, to me, just symbolises everything that I despise about that style of teaching.
He has such a power of personality and powers of persuasion, they can't cope with him. And like the headmaster, every step of the way, he just gets terrorised.
He's convinced that Ferris Bueller is playing a prank on him. It rings the bell, and you get this a message from Ferris saying that he's extremely ill, he can't get out of bed, and he's, in effect, almost on his deathbed.
I'm afraid that in my weakened condition, I could take a nasty spill down the stairs and subject myself to further school absences.
It's a very, very, very funny scene.
You can reach my parents at their places of business.
And the car park attendants take the car out for a bit of a drive, and hence the mileage has increased significantly, and they think that by putting the car into reverse, they'll be able to reverse the mileage. And when it doesn't happen, Cameron, who has really been kept within the constraints of his father's expectations, school's expectations, and life's expectations in general, he suddenly loses control. In the words of Ferris Bueller, he kills the car. I think this film really symbolises what schools as a whole have gone from, and hopefully today we'll be able to symbolise what we're taking it to.
You know, the way that they show films really hasn't changed that much since the start of moving pictures. In fact, that brings us neatly on to the oldest film in our list, released in 1939. Here are just a few comments of the teachers who voted for it. A real tearjerker, transcends decades, and the best school movie ever made.
At 6, a sentimental journey through a schoolmaster's life that won Robert Donat an Oscar. Goodbye, Mr. Chips.
The scene where he sits with the lower school prep group right at the start and they take him to the cleaners is a good example of where you know when you first meet a group for the first time at the start of the school year It's sort of you against them, and there's a feeling of they are going to want to try and get one over on you.
Do you suppose a person in middle age could start life over again and make a go of it?
One of my favourite scenes is when Mr Chips, the middle-aged Mr Chips, goes on holiday to Austria and meets Greer Garson.
Must be tremendously interesting to be a schoolmaster.
I thought so once.
She then hears that he's a teacher and starts to talk about the wonderful things that teaching can do, the way it can motivate and inspire young people. And you see his face, the Robert Donat's face, and you see him transform from being this rather fuddy-duddy middle-aged schoolmaster to someone who realises that teaching can really inspire minds and really transform society.
One of my favourite scenes is the scene where it's during an air raid, and all the boys go into the main hall, and Mr. Chips is standing there, and he grabs for a book.
It may seem to you that the affairs of Julius Caesar in Gaul 2,000 years ago are of somewhat secondary importance.
And I just thought it embodies all of those kind of old traditional English values, which are the best about who the English used to be, that stiff upper lip, you know, we're just going to carry on, despite the fact that the whole of the world is blowing up around us, we're going to do our Latin and construe our Latin grammar.
These dead languages do come to life sometimes, don't they?
He has a last scene with a young boy who is in fact the son of a former pupil who is feeling very, very anxious on his first day.
What do you think of Brookfield?
Oh, it's big, sir.
You'll like it, though, when you get used to it. It's not half such an awful place as it seems the first day.
You understand something about the generations. You understand something about education and the point of, you know, it's handing over the baton.
Goodbye, Mr. Chips.
I would have thought that Goodbye, Mr. Chips displays a kind of sentimentality which teachers should steer clear of, really.
That a sentimental, nostalgic and enchanting Goodbye, Mr. Chips takes us to the halfway stage of our countdown of great school movies. But we have some stunning films coming up.
After the break, sexual shenanigans on a motorbike.
I love the way the kids sort of think, it's my turn to go on the bike. Get it over with.
Rock and roll in the classroom.
It's very in your face, it's very passionate, it's very explosive.
And an on-screen teacher with poetic inspiration.
He's thinking outside the box in an institution which is very rigid.
Welcome back. We're counting down the top 10 great school movies as voted for by thousands of teachers in the biggest poll of its kind. Here's where we've got to so far.
At number 10, the highest-grossing musical of all time, Grease. In at 9, Lulu Serenade Sidney Poitier with To Sir With Love. At 8, teen hormonal havoc in Gregory's Girl. 7, bunking off school with Ferris Bueller's Day Off. And at number 6, a classic tearjerker, Goodbye, Mr. Chips.
OK, here's the deal. I have a hangover. Does anyone know what that means? Actually, I don't. Not today. That was actually Jack Black's opening line to his class of kids in our next movie. He plays a washed-up rocker masquerading as a substitute teacher, and you loved it. One voter said it demonstrates student-centred learning and the role of delegation and inclusion. Rock on. Perhaps someone more in tune with the film said, if you don't smile and laugh at least once during this film, then, dude, you've got a disease.
At number 5, School of Rock, an inspirational oddball teacher turns kids into a rock band.
You guys have been doing real good in here. And if I was going to give you a grade, I would give you an A. But that's the problem. Rock ain't about doing things perfect. Who can tell me what it's really about?
He's trying to instill into them that to write a rock song, because he's so into his rock, I mean, that's his religion, that you've got to be angry. And so he becomes the man. He hates the man.
I'm the man, and who's got the guts to tell me off? Huh? Who's gonna tell me off?
Shut the hell up, Schneebly.
That's it, Freddy.
This film could have been really cheesy. It could not have worked at all. And I think it's completely charming. I think you've got a great cast of young people. I think Jack Black has got this magical charm where he can be funny but not patronising at all. So I think this connection, this very real connection that he has with the kids in the class, that makes it a real delight to watch.
I relate a lot to Jack Black as a teacher when I'm doing the job myself, because I see his passion that he puts in and the way that he conveys a subject to the kids. It's not stuffy, it's not monotone, it's very in your face, it's very passionate, it's very explosive.
When you look at what he does, very traditionally, he stands up at the top of the classroom and dispenses wisdom, even if it's about how to play a guitar riff. And in that way, it's quite traditional pedagogy.
He's transformed these very nerdy kids from school at the beginning when they've got no confidence and they don't really want to play rock music. And at the end, they're these really cool kids who can play their instruments.
Kick some ass!
It's a brilliant film. I've watched it too many times to mention.
We watch that film at home two or three times a year and we sing along. So it's a huge film in my family.
I wish I'd had a teacher like that at school.
Now a movie that wasn't a big hit at the box office but made a big impression with you. Perhaps because of its emphasis on not just learning, but learning how to think. And some terrific writing from Alan Bennett, including the line, "History, it's just one thing after another." One voter described it as a real teacher's movie that will make you sigh with nostalgia.
In at four, the History Boys. Infatuation and forbidden fondling amongst a bunch of grammar school boys cramming to enter Oxford and Cambridge.
How do I define history? It's just one thing after another.
It was really exciting because it went where you're not supposed to go.
And now for some poetry of a more traditional sort.
Oh, God!
Tim, what is this?
Sir, I don't always understand poetry.
You don't always understand it? Tim's, I never understand it.
What Mr. Hector has decided is that he's going to... It's something I decided myself when I was a young teacher. That he was going to fill these boys up with stuff that he knew was mint, that they might not know what it was, but it would never leave them.
I like Hector's character because he believes in education for education's sake. He's not interested in just cramming for exams, which so much of today's culture is about.
What was fascinating for me was that the boys turned out to be so sophisticated. The whole idea, the boys know everything. Good thinking for a teacher. They know everything, but you have to get it out of them.
Who goes home? Well, surely I could give somebody a lift. Who's on pillion duty? Daking.
Not me, sir. I'm going into town.
History Boys is a very complex and interesting play, but I am deeply troubled by it, and I think Bennett wants us to be.
The boys have their own sexual agenda, and the boys know exactly what Mr. Hector is up to. They also know that it isn't going to go any further than being felt up on the back of a motorbike.
I love the way the kids sort of think, oh, it's my turn to go on the bike. Ah, well, you know, get it over with.
It's so sophisticated on the one hand, some of the issues that he addresses about sexuality, about potential child abuse, about, you know, aspiration in terms of, you know, dreaming beyond the place, the social place that you find yourself in.
I thought we might talk about the Holocaust.
Good gracious. How can you teach the Holocaust?
Well, that would do as a question, can you?
Mr. Hector's talking about the obscenity of putting the Holocaust in context.
Not like any other, surely. Not like any other at all.
No, but it's a topic.
I love the way that Mr. Hector teaches that Mr. Irwin gets involved in as well, which is that everybody's arguing.
To you, the Holocaust is just another topic on which we may or may not get a question.
No. No, but this is history. Distance yourselves.
I always say to my students, confusion is the most fruitful state of mind. Hold on to your confusions. Don't irritably reach for certainty.
Now, how does a director get his young cast to really feel like they're back at school? Well, the answer, apparently, is to feed them school meals. That's exactly what John Hughes did while shooting our next movie, and it worked. One teacher commenting on the film said, "This really does capture what it was like to be a teenager." And I agree.
At three, The Breakfast Club. A day in detention becomes a day of self-discovery for five high school delinquents.
Well, well, here we are.
The whole film is about kids being in the most boring setting for like 2 hours. They're in detention. The whole film is about being in detention. No one else is there. But yet, they still have enough passion, enough imagination to make something out of nothing. And the one authority figure, the teacher, who's a real kind of hard man, do it my way or no way, he still can't cope with them because even though they're sat down in their chair, he still can't control them. He's still not their boss.
Yeah, I got a question. Does Barry Manilow know that you raid his wardrobe?
I'll give you the answer to that question, Mr. Bender, next Saturday. Don't mess with the bull, young man. You'll get the horns.
Andy, who's the cool, clean, good-looking wrestler, admits the reason why he physically humiliated another boy in the school, and which is the reason why he's having to do this detention. And he physically humiliated this other boy because he wanted to be a bad boy like his father had been a bad boy.
I started thinking about my father and his attitude about weakness. And the next thing I knew, I jumped on top of him and started wailing on him.
It clearly spoke to a certain generation, both in this country and in the US, an 80s generation, materially pretty well off most of the time, but very lacking in love and other forms of psychological support that help to make people good people.
And I'm gonna kick the living out of you, man. I'm gonna knock your in the dirt.
You threatening me?
What are you gonna do about it?
The angriest scene in the whole film follows a moment where John Bender insults, using the strongest swear word, the teacher in front of the others. It's a moment where the teacher, I felt for him, even though he's a bully and a fool. He has to do something. He cannot accept having the strongest swear words used to him in front of other students.
You're a gutless turd.
People who've been school teachers in difficult schools, like I have, will relate to the arrogant, sneering challenge which some difficult teenagers can offer you as a professional. They will relate to that. They will.
Inevitably, redemption wins out in the end. And I'm not so sure if, with those collection of characters, that might actually happen. Although, I have to remind myself, of course, that this is a movie. It's not real life.
From 80s America to the less glamorous setting of 60s Yorkshire, you called this film classic, brilliant, a breath of fresh air, moving and profound. It introduces us to one of the cheekiest and most unruly pupils on film, as someone tells him, "I wouldn't be your teacher for all the coal in Barnsley." But as he adopts and trains a young kestrel, he proves that it's everyone else who has a lot to learn.
At number two, it's Kez. A boy's hopes and dreams soar as he trains a kestrel. A truly great British film, directed by Ken Loach.
Well, that's very kind of them to say they still like it after all these years. It was made 40 years ago this year, 1968, when the tanks were rolling into Prague. We were making Kes.
Come on, Kes!
Kes is just one of the most amazing films ever. I mean, I remember as a very young person seeing that. I mean, I probably was, I don't know, even 8 or 9, but just to see another young person who was struggling in life and watching that and just having some kind of identity with the fact that sometimes, you know, being a child isn't easy.
I remember the scene where Billy describes to the class how he's trained the bird, and that was something that was really quite touching when we did it, because David did train it.
I saw her fly and she came like a bomb, about a yard off floor, like lightning, head still, and you couldn't hear it wings, they wanted sound front wings, and straight onto the glove, wham, and she'll grab me for me.
His effort to articulate that from a 14-year-old boy was very touching.
Do it again, just to prove that it won't look.
The fact that we have this young boy who's the centre of this story, and it's really, he's the hero of the film, it's the first time I remember seeing a child like myself as a hero.
The funniest scene in the film is the football game, which is just one of the most hilarious kind of comic scenes in any movie.
The boys are assembled by the sadistic PE teacher to play this horrendous game of football, which he cheats like mad and takes a dive and then gets the penalty.
Brian Glover, as the PE teacher, just speaks for all PE teachers, I'm sorry, but he embodies so many PE teachers I've come across in my life, you know, that kind of bossy, pompous, deluded attitude that he has, that really feels he's playing this kind of grandstand match.
Is out to take a penalty.
Caning scene is extremely powerful. I'm told that the children were actually paid to be really caned in order that it should look realistic. I hope they were paid well.
Getting the cane was quite normal then. I mean, it looks like child abuse now, but actually it was quite normal. And the little boy who was caned by mistake cried all the way to the piggy bank, I think, because he got an extra 10 bob for that.
It says everything there is to be said about class, about hope and expectation, about the possibility of poetry in people's lives, and then the dashing of it by the cruelest of means at the end. A truly great film.
Almost time to reveal our top great school movie. But before we do, let's count down the other films that made it into our top 10.
At 10, Bad Boy Danny and Good Girl Sandy get it on in Greece. 9, a 40 years old but still startlingly relevant, To Sir With Love. Number 8, the sweet and charming Gregory's Girl. At 7, it's Ferris Bueller's Day Off. In at 6, a timeless classic, Goodbye, Mr. Chips. 5, Jack Black's A Blast in School of Rock. At 4, history is just one thing after another, The Hilarious History Boys. 3, teenage tearaways blame pushy parents in The Breakfast Club. And at number 2, raw, real and inspiring, it's Kes.
What a list of fantastic films. Now, this movie, our number one great school movie, was top of the class week after week and ended up a clear winner. Why? Well, it's a bit of a mystery, but perhaps it's because the inspirational, caring, rule-breaking Mr. Keating, played with syrupy perfection by Robin Williams, most represents the kind of teacher that you'd like to be. You sentimental lot.
At number one, it's Dead Poets Society. Robin Williams plays the unconventional but charismatic and inspiring teacher, John Keating.
Gather ye rosebuds while ye may. The Latin term for that sentiment is carpe diem. Now, who knows what that means?
Carpe diem. That's seize the day.
Very good, Mr.
Meeks.
Meeks. Another unusual name. Seize the day.
John Keating is an inspirational teacher. He does things that students long for. He takes them out of the classroom very early on in the film. He takes them down to the hall and shows them the photos of the old boys of the school.
I'd like you to step forward over here and peruse some of the faces from the past. They're not that different from you, are they?
And he plays around with them and he jokes around with them. And you can see the boys looking at one another and realising they've got somebody a bit different here.
Just like you feel? Did they wait until it was too late to make from their lives even one iota of what they were capable? Because you see, gentlemen, these boys are now fertilizing daffodils.
Rastafarian poet Benjamin Zephaniah was thrilled to hear that Dead Poets Society made it to number one. He's a huge fan of the movie. We met, appropriately enough, at Bunhill Field Cemetery in London, among some dead poets. William Blake and John Bunyan are both buried here.
So why do you think teachers have voted for this as their favourite grade school movie?
I think it's because they see a creative, inventive, imaginative teacher inspiring children in a way that sometimes they wish they could, but they've got to stick to this rigid curriculum. And I think it's like, yeah, that's the kind of teacher I want to be.
I hereby reconvene the Dead Poets Society.
Yay!
Yay! Dalton Chapter. I went to the woods because I wanted to live deliberately. I wanted to live deep and suck out all the marrow of life.
I'll second that.
To put to rout all that was not life, and not when I had come to die, discover that I had not lived.
I remember when I was in school, discovering that there was another little poet in school, and it was as if we were gay. Yeah, you do poetry as well. And it was like, okay, we found a little corner in the playground. It was like, you show me yours and I'll show you mine. we had this little thing going on. And, you know, and it was our live poet society, if you like. There was only two of us. But we felt like we was in a little world of our own, but we had something special between us.
Yes.
Rip out the entire page. You heard me. Rip it out.
Thank you, Mr. Dalton.
When you see a film where it actually shows them, no, these kids can be independent, they can make their own decisions, they can be the success that they've always dreamed about, and you can help in some way, I mean, that's why most people go into teaching. It's the buzz.
What is good about Dead Poets Society is it really shows the chemistry that can exist between you and a group. And I suppose I can look back on my teaching career and say, yes, at times, that was really good. That was a fantastic lesson. And yes, I did feel like Robin Williams.
Captain, my captain.
Sit down, Mr. Anderson.
So there we are, Dead Poets Society number one. But what does this say about all the thousands of teachers who took part in the poll? And most importantly, who they aspire to be? For a voter's view, I turn to Stacey Jordan, an English teacher who was one of the first to cast her vote for Dead Poets Society, of course.
It just encompasses what we as teachers are trying to do in schools. Robin Williams' character is inspirational for the students that he's teaching and is inspirational for us as an audience.
And then the final real big tear-joking moment at the end when Mr. Keating is sacked and all the kids get up onto the desk and say that famous, "Oh, Captain, my Captain." I mean, did that really get you?
Definitely. Just we're all rooting for the students to support Robin Williams at this point. We want them to accept some responsibility, show that they're young men, and when Ethan Hawke's character stands on the table, we're all just absolutely rooting for him as an audience, and we're so pleased when they all stand up and follow suit. It sums up what we as English teachers, and certainly teachers across the world really, are trying to do. We want to inspire students, we want to get them to think for themselves and to not necessarily do what tradition has set forward as the way.
Carpe diem.
Definitely.
Yeah. What does this say about teachers that they've voted for these?
Well, I think it just presents such a wide spectrum of what teachers are and what teachers hope to be, and it is aspirational and inspirational, and we've got films such as Kes, where we've got a very negative influence, right through to School of Rock, where we've got real inspiration and just throwing the rule books out the window.
Very romantic.
Definitely.
Isn't it, though, as an idea that teachers can change the world, one kid at a time?
I think that we can change the world one kid at a time. And if you don't believe that, you shouldn't be in education, really. And these films are testimony to that, really. We are there to make a difference to these children's lives, to help them find out what they're passionate about, mm-hmm. and to pursue that when they grow up.
Well, that's it from Great School Movies. Well done to anyone who voted and to Dead Poets Societies for coming in number one. And I'll leave you with a quote from that cinematic gem. No matter what anybody tells you, words and ideas can change the world. Only Robin Williams could get away with stuff like that. Bye-bye.